Last spring, all eyes were on the deadly impact of COVID-19 in long-term care, but other congregate settings were also at risk, and some closed altogether. Ashley Okwuosa is an assistant editor at tbo.org, and she's been examining one of those in Brampton. She joins us now from the provincial capital on that. Good to see you, Ashley.
Good to see you, Jan.
Now, you wrote about the Ontario Correctional Institute, also known as the OCI. It closed quite early into the pandemic. Can you tell us about the events that sort of led to that closure?
Sure. And before I even go into the events, I think it's best to really describe OCI and what it is. You know, OCI is a residential facility. So it's not really a correctional facility in the way that we think of it. You know, we think of cells and segregation, centers, but OCI is, I was told, it's 99% a dormitory facility. So it's a lot of communal spaces, a lot of open living. You know, and that was something that definitely did cause concern for a lot of correctional workers and residents who, you know, were at OCI. They were kind of worried when the pandemic, you know, first started. So things happened really quickly. I think on April 11th, Peel Public Health confirmed to the ministry its first positive case at OCI. By April 15th, programming, you know, had been suspended. The facility went under an institutional lockdown and Peel Public Health officially declared an outbreak. So matter of 4 days. By April 20th, all the residents had been moved out of OCI to other facilities across the province, and it was temporarily closed. So this is more than a year ago. At the time of the closure, there were about 109 residents at OCI, and according to the ministry, 91 tested positive. So that means over 80% of the resident population tested positive at that time, or you know, during the duration of the closure.
Now, for your upcoming article, you've obtained Freedom of Information documents. Was there anything interesting that was revealed in those?
What I think was interesting, so I was able to get a few documents, a pandemic plan. So all institutions have their own pandemic plan, which actually helps them deal with, you know, in OCI's case, it was dated March 2020, and it was supposed to help, you know, navigate, you know, through an influenza pandemic, which, you know, is very interesting. So it kind of detailed, like, you know, appropriate mask wearing, social distancing guidelines, things like that to kind of help navigate, you know, that kind of situation. I was also able to get memos and emails, and what that really did was help create this timeline. And when you're looking through these emails and these memos, it really shows how quickly things were moving. You know, there were memos sent almost on the same day, you know, going from suspension of programming to an institutional lockdown, which limits movement within the facility. So it just really did indicate how quickly things changed.
Now, you did get a chance to speak to some staff and got a sense of how residents were thinking about how the situation was being handled. What did they have to say about that?
So, you know, the words of one correctional worker, they said that they really felt let down, you know, by the ministry, simply because they felt like the ministry should have understood that because OCI is such a unique setting, you know, it's not the only dormitory facility in Ontario, but, you know, just because of its unique setting, the ministry should have understood the risk, right? So, you know, I have union representatives who said that they had been speaking or at least proposing preventative measures, and not just at OCI, but at correctional facilities across the province as early as January. And the response was always that, you know, it's not time, you know? So I think in their exact words, the ministry was more, reactive than proactive. So I think that was really the sense of frustration that hopefully this could have been prevented.
Now I want to make sure we get a sense of the other side. Do we have any responses from government and from unions as well?
Yeah, so the government definitely, you know, I think they were relatively candid just about what they were able to do. They did implement, you know, guidelines just in terms of, you know, hand washing. They did explicitly mention, and this was also told to me by correctional workers, you know, enhanced cleaning measures, you know, and they, I think this is not exactly from the government, but this is someone who spoke, you know, to kind of contextualize things. And they mentioned that the ministry was really learning about some of the implicit risks of COVID-19 as everyone else was, right? So asymptomatic spread, a lot of things were, you know, everyone was kind of learning at the same time. So that was something that did help put things into context. But the ministry did talk about some of the responses that they put in place prior to the outbreak and after the outbreak at OCI.
Now, you had mentioned the 90 plus inmates or residents at OCI who tested positive. These weren't the only inmates and correctional facilities that had outbreaks. They were moved on to other facilities that had outbreaks later on. Can you tell us, has anything been learned from these situations in terms of these institutions?
Yeah, you know, you're right. Other facilities did have outbreaks. Maplehurst and Toronto South are some examples. You know, I can't say what's been learned, but what I did think was interesting and insight, you know, from someone that I spoke to, and they said that one thing that would help, you know, is really, you know, there's so many things, you know, there are variants, there's a symptomatic spread, so it's difficult to kind of know, you know, but one thing that would help is really how information about public health measures are passed on to local facilities. So right now they kind of describe this chain where information goes from a public health, local public health unit to the ministry and then back to the local facility, right? So, you know, it's kind of, you know, unwieldy and just kind of long. So I think what they were proposing or advocating for is direct information from local public health units to facilities directly. You know, facilities will be able to get regional specific information, and things like contact tracing will probably be able to happen faster. So that was one thing that this person was advocating for.
That's great stuff, Ashley. Thank you so much.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is made possible through generous philanthropic contributions from viewers like you. Thank you for supporting TVO's journalism.